Blind Dating the Alpha Prince. Chapter 2. Carter's Point of View.
Carter!
My father's growled yell echoes through the darkened room as he slams the door behind him. The woman on her knees in front of me is so surprised at the interruption that her jaw tightens.
Fuck!
I gasp in a whisper as her sharp teeth come perilously close to severing my most important body part. Or at least that's what it feels like to me, and I quickly pull out of her mouth before she can do any further damage.
I'm sorry, Your Highness.
She whimpers in apology. But I'm only half paying attention as I tuck myself back into my pants before my father can find me like this.
Carter, I know you're in here. I can smell you.
His menacing tone is getting closer, and I shove the woman at my feet further under my desk. I grab some papers and shuffle them around to try to look busy, and I claim,
I'm working!
In the dark? He snarls, not buying it for a second. A moment later, he stands in front of me, glowering down at me.
I know exactly what kind of work you're doing. Whoever's under the desk, get out of there. Now!
Obviously, he's not fooled, so I roll my chair back to let the woman escape. She gets to her feet, her cheeks burning red in the moonlight that's coming in my office window.
Your Majesty, I was just...
I know what you were just doing. You're Cedric's daughter?
Yes, Your Majesty.
She was? I didn't know that. I had just noticed the pretty face at the ball. I hadn't bothered to get her life story.
Go tell him that his services are no longer required.
No, please, Your Majesty, it's not his fault. My father loves serving you.
Then he should have raised his daughter better. Get out. Now.
The tears start to flow as the girl, whose name I still didn't know, runs out of the office and out into the hall, leaving the door open behind her. I can see my father's face a bit better, and as I expect, he's furious. I can't help but find it all a bit funny, though. Then I point out, it hardly seems fair to punish her father when it's your own son who she was fooling around with. Doesn't that make it equally your fault?
Everyone at this court knows what kind of man you are. If my advisors can't even convince their own daughters to stay away from you, how can I trust their judgment on anything else?
I shrug. This conversation is starting to bore me already. I'm just disappointed I didn't even get to finish the blowjob before we were interrupted. Guess that means I'll be flying solo when I get back to my room.
I want to see you first thing tomorrow morning in my private office.
My father says, turning to head back to the door.
This has to stop, Carter. I'm running out of advisors.
It's not exactly first thing in the morning by the time I get up and get down to my father's office, but it's pretty early by my standards. I'm surprised when I walk in to see that not only is my father there, but my mother is too. She doesn't usually get involved in my father's business, so I have a bad feeling that whatever they want to talk to me about, it's personal rather than professional. My father sends everyone else out of the room. When the door closes, my mother turns to me with a serious expression.
Carter, we're worried about you.
I try not to smile, knowing it'll only upset them more. Because I'm having a little fun while I'm young. It's hardly a crime. No one is with me against their will.
You're not a boy anymore. You'll be 25 soon. And it's affecting not only your reputation, but the whole court. I'd like to retire before long. But who's going to trust you to run the Empire when you can't even control yourself?
If only you could have your destined mate.
My mother sighs. But my father doesn't let her go too far down that path.
There's no use in if onlys.
He reminds her, a little harshly, but we all know his harshness is partly because of guilt. It's his fault I'll never have a mate after all. Is that why I am the way I am? Maybe a little bit. After all, what's the point in saving myself for the perfect partner when I know she's not out there? When my mate bond was broken beyond repair, I lost all chance of ever finding the kind of connection that my parents have, or that half the wolves in the castle have. Even the lowliest Omega in the royal pack gets to have a mate. But not me. My father says to me now, "There's no reason you can't have a chosen mate. Humans do it all the time, after all. You just need to pick a woman to settle down with. Surely with all the ones you've tried, someone must appeal to you. They're all the same. They're only interested in me for my position. My mate would have been meant for me, but everyone else, they only want to be queen someday." I wrinkle my nose at the thought.
"So, maybe you need to get to know a woman before she knows who you are."
"And how would I do that? Everyone in the whole empire knows my face. I was on TV, on the cover of magazines. I'd never met anyone who didn't know who I was. The idea intrigued me. I couldn't see how it would work."
"Leave that to me. If you promise that you'll give it a proper chance, I'll make the arrangements."
My mother insists, her fingers twitching in anticipation. Do I actually want to do this? It might be good for a laugh, if nothing else. I was getting a little bored of the endless parade of women who fell into my bed after all. It would be a new challenge to try to seduce some who didn't just see my crown when they look at me. I can't imagine that I would actually fall in love with any of them. But there didn't seem to be any harm in giving it a try. "All right. Go ahead."
"Just give me a few days to set it all up,"
she requests, and I nod, turning to go back to my own office.
"And no more whoring before then,"
my father calls out after me. I roll my eyes and keep walking. It's only been a week, and I'm ready to call this whole experiment off. When my mother first suggested putting me on mate match wearing a mask over my face, I actually thought it was pretty clever, and I was quickly proved right. Everyone was talking about it. Beautiful women were posting clips of themselves applying for a date with me, and I couldn't wait to meet some of them in person. But what I didn't realize was that my mother was going to be the one screening the applications. I found her the day after the profile went up with a stack of papers at our private dining table. "What are those?" I asked as I sat down next to her, waiting for one of the servants to bring me breakfast.
"Your potential dates,"
she explained, and I quickly grabbed some of the papers from the pile over her protests. "Wait, there's no pictures on these." I frowned as I flipped through them. Each one had a blank box where the picture should be. She snatched the papers back from my hand and then told me,
"Because I'm interested in finding the woman who's right for you on the inside, just like your mate would be."
There's the usual little sting at the thought of my mate, whoever she was meant to be. I asked, "And you're going to be able to tell that from a few questions?"
"I have a good feeling about it."
Her confidence made me feel a little better, until I started going on the dates. First of all, my mother insisted that I keep the mask on for the whole date. She pointed out to me,
"It won't work if word gets out who you are. If you like someone enough to have 5 dates, then you can take it off."
5 dates? With the same woman? That seemed an impossible feat. Then there were the women themselves. They didn't seem as bothered by the mask as I expected them to be. The first two even said they liked it, going off on a tangent about how society puts too much value on appearances. From the looks of them, I could see why they'd think so. I put an end to those dates as quickly as possible. The woman the third night was better. She was really quite pretty, and I recognized her too. She was a doctor at the Royal Hospital, the youngest doctor we'd had in the Empire. I remembered my father being particularly impressed with her when she qualified. So I actually made an honest effort with her, being my usual charming self. But she seemed far less charmed by me than women usually were. She wanted to talk about goals and life plans, things that I had never particularly worried about before. I knew what my life plan was. It was to become king once my father retired. But I couldn't tell her that without giving away my identity. In the end, I offered a second date, and she turned me down. No one had ever turned down a date with me before, and I had to admit it was a blow to my confidence. In frustration, I blew off my date the next night, not even turning up for it, to my mother's annoyance.
You promised me you'd give this an honest try.
I have! It's not working!
Try harder, Carter.
She tells me I'm having dinner with another woman tonight, and I try my best to get out of it, but she refuses to budge.
This one could be really good for you.
You've said that about all of them, I point out, but I know it's useless. She's made up her mind. Fine. I'll go out tonight, but the weekend is mine. She agrees to that compromise, and I manage to forget about my upcoming date until it's almost time for me to go. I'm not expecting much, so I don't make much of an effort either. I run a comb through my hair and slip the mask on my face once I arrive at the restaurant. Bit table, of course, so I'm taken straight in and seated. My date isn't there yet. As I keep an eye on my watch, I begin to hope that maybe she won't turn up. Then my mother can't blame me for not trying, but I can still have the rest of the night free. There must be a party somewhere that I could go. Maybe I'll even take the mask. If people recognize it from the dating app, it might work in my favor. Just as I think I've waited long enough and start to get to my feet, my date walks in, and I stop halfway. She is absolutely stunning. Long, chocolatey brown hair falls in waves over her shoulders. Her dress is a little loose, so I can't get a full sense of her shape, but she's got great legs beneath it. But the thing I notice most of all is her eyes. They're a vibrant blue beneath thick eyelashes. I can definitely picture her in my bed later on. So I sit back down. Maybe tonight won't be so bad after all.